Okay, colleagues, the next item of business is the well-trailed members' business debate in the name of Jackson Carlow on motion 2600 on Holocaust Memorial Day to be marked on 27th January 2022. The debate will be concluded without any questions being posed, but I'd invite members who wish to contribute to press the request to speak buttons now or as soon as possible. I'll place an hour in the chat function, and I call on Mr. Carlow to open the debate for around 7 minutes, Mr. Carlow.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Holocaust Memorial Day is younger than this Parliament. It was first commemorated in 2005. And it's been a privilege in the years since I joined this Parliament in 2007 to have in some years proposed motions, in others to have participated in the debate, and more often to have just listened with appreciation to the contributions from all parts of this chamber. My life began in a community full of Jewish neighbours and friends. Many I know now had first-hand experience of the horrors of the industrialised Nazi-perpetrated Holocaust. For decades, their memories kept to themselves, often even from their immediate family. Just as I remember that moment when Harry Patch died in 2009, the last survivor of the conflict on the Western Front in the Great War, it's clear that we are close to a moment when the diminishing number of survivors of the Holocaust will be with us no longer. I'm profoundly appreciative of the fact that I grew up in a community so rich in Jewish heritage. However, the surviving elected parliamentary constituency representatives of my Eastwood community, Kirsten Oswald, Paul Masterton, and in particular Jim Murphy and my predecessor Ken McIntosh and I, are in all likelihood the last who will come to know and learn from those who were here or who survived the Holocaust. In the last 18 months, Eastwood has lost two of its most formidable yet charismatic members of our community. Judith Rosenberg, Scotland's last survivor of Auschwitz, and Ingrid Guga, a beneficiary with her husband Henry of the Kinder transport just a few weeks before the outbreak of war in 1939. Ingrid and Henry Guga settled in Glasgow, and tirelessly until her death in her 90s, Ingrid actively supported the work of Holocaust education and awareness in schools and communities. In her last 5 years alone, in her 90s, speaking to some 5,000 adults and children through the Holocaust Educational Trust's outreach programme. For her work, she was awarded the British Empire Medal and is survived by Henry, still a familiar presence where he lives in Eastwood Toll. Indeed, I'm delighted that at a rather splendid age of 97, he was able to both participate in Scotland's national commemoration last night and grant an interview to Good Morning Scotland this morning. Holocaust Memorial Day is commemorated on the anniversary of the date of the liberation of the Auschwitz extermination camp, this day in 1945 by Soviet forces advancing from the east. I last met Judith Rosenberg, who died just a few days past in January last year at the age of 98, shortly before the restrictions brought about by the current pandemic. She was as bright as ever. What distinguished her testimony was that her recollections were of her experience at Auschwitz, not as an infant or even as a child, but as a young adult woman of 22. And she could remember events with extraordinary clarity. Her story may be familiar, but nothing could be more affecting than to hear it firsthand. The torturous cattle truck train journey, during which her father helped pile corpses of those who had perished in the atrocious cramped conditions in a corner of the carriage. The lack of food and water, having to hack the floor of the carriage to establish drainage for waste, something not achieved by many. Most of all, the final message of her father as the train pulled to a halt at Auschwitz, somewhere I know members of this Parliament have stood. If the Germans ever offer you options, always choose the hard option, because there will be an ulterior motive. And although she was not to see her father again, it was his advice that saved Judith, her mother and sister. They took it and chose the option of walking the final 3 kilometres at Auschwitz when all those who opted for transport were immediately murdered in the gas chambers. She survived, but the privations and torments of her subsequent time there were appalling. 4 months after her arrival, she was finally sent in September 1944 for a first shower in a building with a notice gas camera. You can imagine her terror. However, for her at least, it was just a shower. Sent to a munitions factory, she borrowed from her pre-war experience of her family watchmaking business, which was to earn her extra provisions and also save her sister and mother. With a facility for languages, she was employed as an interpreter. After liberation by the Americans in April 1945, she met and fell for a young army officer, Lieutenant Harold Rosenberg, who she said never left her side for the next 60 years, having lobbied personally and successfully for permission from Field Marshal Bernard Montgomery himself to marry. They settled in Giffnock in Eastwood. Presiding Officer, Judith Rosenberg, Scotland's last survivor of Auschwitz. I've dwelt on Judith and Ingrid's stories because this was a Holocaust visited on people, on individuals, on those in our community now who lost parents, grandparents, and countless relatives and friends. And we should never lose sight of the personal in any commemoration of the remembrance of the Holocaust. Auschwitz may have been liberated on this day in 1945, but it was this week in 1942, almost 80 years ago, that the infamous Wannsee Conference took place and its notorious protocol was agreed. There, under the cold direction of Reinhard Heydrich, scribed by Adolf Eichmann, that the world's first Holocaust was signed off, an audit of Europe's 11 million Jews, and a systematic plan to murder them all as Nazi conquest prevailed, and to do so without delay as, to quote the minute, useless mouths should not be fed. The one surviving copy of the protocol, Colin Evans Nuremberg, is municipally bland, even if its meaning is anything but. This, then, was the final destination of Nazi anti-Semitism, of the relentless prejudice and persecution systematically prosecuted and entrenched since Hitler came to power in 1932. Hundreds of thousands had by then already been murdered, but now and within weeks, extermination was to progress on an unprecedented scale and with an unprecedented fervour, claiming the lives of 6 million Jews and millions more besides. Hitler's final solution. Presiding Officer, the theme of this year's Holocaust Memorial Day is one day in history. Any day, of course, can be held in the memory quite differently, depending on where you happen to be, and this was true of every single day during World War II. The Holocaust Memorial Trust offers chilling examples. The 19th of April 1943, where the Jewish inhabitants of the Warsaw Ghetto fought back against the Nazis. The 12th of July 1995 in Bosnia, which was the last day large numbers of women saw their husbands, fathers, sons and brothers. Despite being designated by the UN as a safe area, Bosnia Serb soldiers entered Srebrenica and started to separate Bosniak men and women and children. 8,000 Bosniak men and boys were subsequently murdered in and around Srebrenica. Or the 17th of April 1975, where the Khmer Rouge moved into the Cambodian capital. The entry of the Khmer Rouge resulted in a five-year campaign of terror, and 2 million people were murdered by Pol Pot. Or the days, 100 of them, in 1994, when around 1 million Tutsis and moderate Hutus were murdered in Rwanda. Presiding Officer, anti-Semitism and racial, sexual and genetic prejudice were not the unique preserver of Nazi Germany. In a previous debate, I noted that the year after World War II, 1946, more Jews were murdered across Europe than in the 13 years combined before the war itself. Many were killed where they stood when they finally made it back to homes now occupied by others. Nazi Germany fell. Anti-Semitism existed before and has prevailed since, and has done so across our continent as much as anywhere else. Of those other atrocities just mentioned, 1975, 1994, 1995, were all shamefully in my lifetime. How hollow the mantra, never again. Holocaust Memorial Day serves not just as a commemoration of those lost, not only in the Holocaust itself, but in the multiple genocides throughout the near 80 years since. Importantly, it must remind us of an enduring and permanent duty, not just to pay lip service in days like this, but to confront, challenge, educate and defeat the forces harbouring and perpetuating genocidal schemes and all that underpin and facilitate them. Presiding Officer, like many, I have wept at the horror and barbarism of the Holocaust and the genocides in my lifetime. Have we failed? Sometimes it overwhelmingly feels like we have. What must our response be? There can be no other choice. We must rededicate ourselves to meeting the challenge every year, every decade, every generation. In so doing, we honour those that were lost. And I know, Presiding Officer, as a Parliament and as a country, we will do this together.
Thank you very much indeed, Mr. Carlow. I now move to the open debate and I call Annabel Ewing for around 4 minutes, Ms. Ewing.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. It is, as ever, a great privilege to be able to speak in this debate this afternoon. And I congratulate Jackson Carlow on securing the debate and I commend him for his very thought-provoking speech. This annual members' debate is vitally important as we therefore can remember the 6 million Jews murdered by the Nazis and others. And, of course, so that we can reflect on the genocides that we have witnessed since that time, in our lifetime, the point well made by Jackson Carlow. And I'm reflecting on what I hope to say this year, the 77th anniversary to this very day of the liberation of Auschwitz-Birkenau. I kept coming back to the life of one young Jewish girl whose story has resonated across the world, and that, of course, is the life of Anne Frank, whose diary entitled The Diary of a Young Girl is known so well to us all, and which I read for the first time as a young girl myself. Anne was just 13 years old when she and her family went into hiding from the Nazis in July 1942 in Amsterdam, and her diary reflects the hopes and thoughts of every young girl of her time and of every time. Meet Gies, who had worked for Anne's father and who helped the Frank family to hide and to stay hidden at great risk to her own life, it must be noted, also wrote a book about those times entitled Anne Frank Remembered, and I commend that book as well worth a read. In her observations, she recalled that Anne's tiny bedroom wall in the hidden annex was covered with pictures, photos of the big movie stars of the day like Ray Milland, Greta Garbo, Norma Shearer, Ginger Rogers, and cutouts of cuddly little babies, a photo of a big pink rose, a photo of chimpanzees having a tea party. So humour and compassion, glamour, beauty, and the natural world, the many interests of a young girl, even one who was in hiding for her life. And as someone who has been a young girl, I can well imagine the montage Anne had created and what it meant to her. Meet Gies made near daily life-saving visits to the Frank family, bringing them food and supplies and books and basic humanity. Meet Gies observed in the summer of 1943, Anne having turned 14 years old, that, and I quote, Anne was spontaneous and still childish sometimes, but she had gradually acquired a new coyness and a new maturity. Meet Gies went on to add in her recollections of that time that Anne had arrived a girl, but she would leave a woman. As we know, Presiding Officer, Anne was never to reach womanhood. The Frank family were caught by the Nazis on 4th August 1944, after having been in hiding for 25 months. Anne, along with her older sister, Margot, died in Bergen-Belsen in early spring 1945, just a few short months of what would have been her 16th birthday. However, Anne's diary lives on as it speaks to every young Jewish girl of the Holocaust, to those who did not, like Anne, reach womanhood, as well as to those who did, but were unutterably altered. It speaks to those young Jewish girls whose entire families were murdered by the clinical, calculated killing machine that was Nazi Germany. It speaks to those young Jewish girls who therefore had no mother, no father, no grandmother, no grandfather, no uncles, no aunts, and no brothers, and no sisters. It speaks to those young Jewish girls who had to try to make a life following liberation against the backdrop of the barbarism and the obscenity that had been visited upon them. And it speaks to those young Jewish girls who had lost their hopes, their dreams, their aspirations, and their very belief in humanity. And so, Presiding Officer, for every young Jewish girl, I bear witness. Thank you.
Thank you very much indeed, Ms. Hume. I now call on Shannon Dowie to be followed by Kenneth Gibson again for 4 minutes, Ms. Dowie.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. It's a privilege to speak in today's Holocaust Memorial Day debate and join members in remembering all those who have lost their lives in the Holocaust and in genocide since. While we remember the victims of Nazi persecution, mainly the Jews, it is also worth noting that Roma and Sinti people, gay people, political opponents, religious leaders, Jehovah's Witnesses and countless others found themselves in concentration camps, suffering not just at the hands of the Nazis, but their collaborators as well. You would hope with the arrival of the new millennium, we might have seen some change, but the list stretches on right up until today. For people in Myanmar or Kurdistan, genocide is not some distant memory, but a reality they must live with and we must confront rather than commemorate. Others in the chamber will discuss these stories with more depth and poignancy than I can do in 4 minutes, so instead I want to shine a light on some of the small but significant roles that people of Ayrshire played in the Holocaust. Take the story of Laura Zimmerman, aged 8, Lord was one of thousands of child refugees who came to Scotland and the UK through the Kinder Transport Scheme. Having fled Germany to Prague due to her communist parents, Lore then came to Britain, finding herself at Rozelle House in Ayr, under the care of Colonel Claude Hamilton and his wife Veronica. Then there is the story of Suzanne Schaefer, a 12-year-old Jewish girl from Berlin who also came to stay at Rozelle. Or Martha Rosenzweig, again 12, for whom the Hamiltons found a home in Minishant. Meanwhile, the Fultons of Carrick Lodge took in 5 refugees 5 months before the war had even started, including an 8-year-old and a young man who had been in a concentration camp. In a 1939 edition of the Ayrshire Post, Mrs. Fulton wrote, "More refugees are expected in the near future," before making an appeal for clothes and accommodation, and an echo of the arrival of Afghan refugees today. Then there is Ingrid Wooger, born in Dortmund and who I know the First Minister met before she sadly passed away, escaping Hitler's Germany aged 15 on Kinder transport. Ingrid came to Ayrshire, finding a job sewing uniforms. Ingrid and her husband dedicated themselves to telling the tale of the Holocaust, with over 5,000 people hearing her testimony. Quite rightly, she was awarded a British Empire Medal for services to Holocaust education in 2019. And this brings me to my final point. While these stories are touching and remind us that humanity can shine through in even the darkest of times, as times go by, the Holocaust will, unfortunately, cease to be a living memory. Many survivors, like Ingrid, directed education efforts worldwide, speaking about the horrors that they lived through. But that experience is slipping away, and as we all know too well, history is all too often doomed to repeat itself. At 8 p.m. tonight, I'll be joining others across the UK and lighting a candle in my window in remembrance of all those who have lost their lives to genocide. These small acts are what keeps the Holocaust alive in the public memory, and I would encourage everyone here to do the same. Thank you.
Thank you very much indeed, Ms Dye. I now call on Kenneth Gibson to be followed by Sarah Boyack. Again, 4 minutes, Mr Gibson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. On this Holocaust Memorial Day, I thank Jackson Carlaw for bringing this debate to the Chamber and for his excellent, moving and thought-provoking speech. I know this is a subject particularly close to the Jewish community in Scotland, many of whom reside in Jackson's constituency. And my thoughts are with those who were murdered and who suffered through the impact of the Holocaust. This year's theme, One Day, will mean different things to different people. We can hope that one day there will be no more persecution or genocide, yet the fact that oppression of minorities has existed for millennia and impacted all corners of the globe does not bode well for that premise. One day can also change a life. Setting in motion a chain of events symbolising horrendous times, it can make one person the face of 6 million. And one such day was the warm, sunny 4th of August 1944, when the lives of the Frank and Van Pels families and Fritz Pfeffer changed drastically, as did those of their selfless helpers. After 2 years hiding in an Amsterdam annex with no way of going outside, having to be quiet and living together with zero respite, no room for children to be young, unable to stretch their legs or breathe fresh air, they were discovered. Of the 8 members of those 2 families, only Otto Frank survived. And as Annabel Jung told us so, again so movingly in her excellent speech, his daughters Anne and Margot, just teenagers, died of typhus and hunger in Belsenbergen just a few months later. The outcome of a 6-year investigation by an international cold case team led by a retired FBI agent concluded a notary and member of the Jewish Council pointed the Nazis towards a secret attic. I won't name him as I'm not convinced conclusive evidence has been produced. Concerns have also been expressed by expert Dutch historians in the Anne Frank Foundation, who said, "There's much to be said for following this trail, but the argument underlying the new betrayal theory is based on a number of assumptions, and no conclusive evidence has been found. More research is needed." It still hasn't been proven that betrayal took place, and it's possible the discovery was collateral to a raid in the offices in the front house where minor business illegalities took place. Furthermore, the alleged traitor and his family had gone into hiding in 1943 and remained so for most of the war. With so many factors remaining unexplained, how can we so easily accuse someone of sending people to their deaths? I believe we should be particularly careful of adopting a narrative that Jews, under threat of their own families being murdered, are to blame for Holocaust deaths. I've spoken in many previous debates of the horrific crimes inflicted on Jewish people, so I will not do so today. What befell the few who survived? What happened when they returned to what they once called home? A young Jewish woman called Blanka Rothschild made her way home to Lodz, Poland, from Sachsenhausen concentration camp Berlin, where she had been a slave labourer. After a long, dangerous and arduous journey, the caretaker of the building she once lived in tried to stop her from going upstairs to her family home. When she did so, the people who had moved into her apartment wouldn't let her in and threatened her. Wandering, Blanka was taken to a chaotic, Spartan and overcrowded displaced persons camp where suicide and despair were all too common. Knowing no one and feeling lost, traumatised and bewildered, eventually she ended up in the United States. And there are countless stories like this. Surviving Jews were driven away from their pre-war communities by the thousand and murdered by the hundreds in post-war Europe, 47 in the town of Kielce, Poland, and one particularly vicious pogrom where only 200 of the city's 30,000 pre-war Jewish population had survived. Presiding officer, today persecutions continue in Myanmar against the Rohingya under the watchful eye of the formerly virtuous Aung San Suu Kyi. China has been killing, torturing and re-educating Uyghur Muslims for years, while the world merely gears up for the Beijing Winter Olympics. Rwanda and Srebrenica took place only in the 90s. Not only today, but every day, let us remember the millions murdered in the Holocaust and all other genocides, who suffered in concentration camps, ghettos and the killing fields, those who endured months and years of existing in secret hideouts, and the heroic individuals who risked all to help and those who found refuge elsewhere. And finally, let us encourage others to speak out and challenge discrimination and persecution. Then maybe one day it will stop.
Thank you very much, Mr. Gibson. And I call on Sarah Boyack to be followed by Colette Stevenson. Again, 4 minutes, Ms. Boyack.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I want to start by thanking Jackson Carlaw for bringing today's member debate, but also for his powerful speech to the Chamber today. And as we gather to commemorate Holocaust Memorial Day, it's an act of remembrance, respect, and a commitment not to forget the horrors that Jewish people suffered, the fear they experienced in their lives, and the 6 million Jews who died as a result of the Nazi policy of extermination, and also to reflect on the 11 million others who died under the Nazi regime. And as colleagues have powerfully noted today, today commemorates the date that Auschwitz concentration camp was liberated by the Red Army. But I want to use my speech today to reflect on the fantastic event I attended yesterday by the Edinburgh International Faith Association. It was a moving event and it focused on this year's theme, One Day. It was a call for us to unite in solidarity against intolerance, harassment and the intimidation that people still experience today because of their faith. And the speeches we heard captured that need to remember now and in the future. In my studies at university, for example, the Holocaust was modern history. We still had a raft of family members who were alive during the Second World War. And as a child, I remember my father's Jewish friend and colleague who'd come with his wife to make a new life in Scotland. But to young people today, the Holocaust is history. They won't have those family connections. So the memories that survivors today share with us are especially precious. And we need to share those experiences. So I want to call on members to check out and share the video that was broadcast yesterday by the Edinburgh International Faith Association. It gives a platform to the voices of survivors, such as Henry Wuga, to say in a way that is powerful as well as emotional, just on one day, how their lives were changed forever. But it's also a challenge to us and to society to reflect on how we come together. And as colleagues have highlighted across the chamber, in recent years, we've had genocide in Cambodia, Rwanda, Darfur, and Bosnia. So there's a challenge to us as MSPs from different parties to come together on this issue, to build a more inclusive society, because people are still being attacked because of their religious beliefs and their ethnic backgrounds. And as Professor Joe Goldblatt noted in The Scotsman this week, anti-Semitism has been in the rise in the last decade. But shockingly, 47% increase in anti-Semitism in the first 6 months of last year. So I left yesterday's interfaith event uplifted, moved, also by the art of school pupils from Preston Street and Longstone Primary Schools, whose art was inspiring. But I want to say we have a responsibility not just to keep memories alive, not just to communicate with young people, but to think about how we redouble our work to celebrate the world we live in, to create a more diverse world. And as Emma, a young Jewish student, put it brilliantly yesterday, We need to recognise the importance of biodiversity, not just for our planet, but for humanity, to celebrate our cultural and ethnic diversity. And Holocaust Memorial Day is a reminder that we have a responsibility to support interfaith dialogue, to live in harmony, and to support peacekeeping across the world to keep humanity safe. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Ms. Boyack. And I call on Colette Stevenson to be followed by Maggie Chapman. Again, 4 minutes, Ms. Stevenson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I thank Jackson Carlow for bringing this important debate today. It's crucial for us all to reflect upon the Holocaust, an absolutely tragic part of human history, and also the years preceding it. A vicious spiral of othering, of discrimination and of Nazi persecution of Jewish people and many others. Families forced to flee or live in fear of their life, children separated from their parents and communities destroyed. We must never forget that 6 million Jewish people were murdered in Europe in that barbaric period. But we must also remember the personal stories of those whose lives were taken too soon and of those who survived. I commend the work of the Holocaust Educational Trust, which is vital in that regard. I welcome the UN's recent resolution to further tackle antisemitism and Holocaust denial. But it is painful that those prejudices and hate towards entire groups of people, including Jews, are still here. Just as the defeat of the Nazis was not the end of antisemitism, nor was the Holocaust the end of genocide. Sadly, as Jackson Carlow points out, since 1945, the world has witnessed genocide in Rwanda, Darfur, Bosnia and Cambodia. This year's Holocaust Memorial Day theme of one day gives lots to think about. Clearly, we hope that one day there is no more genocide. As politicians, it is right that we talk about and reflect on the horrors of genocide. But it is also necessary for us all to champion equality and tolerance, support organisations like the Holocaust Memorial Day Trust, and spread the messages from today's debate in our communities. In one of his books, Eli Wiesel mentioned a peer in Auschwitz who talked about the need for hope that one day, quote, we shall all see the day of liberation. Thankfully, many people did see that day. On that theme, I want to talk about Lanarkshire's own Ian Forsyth, who sadly passed away last month. Ian was one of the first soldiers to arrive and liberate the Bergen-Belsen concentration camp in 1945. Having witnessed the worst of man's behaviour towards fellow human beings, that day never left Ian. For the rest of his life, he dedicated himself to Holocaust education. A couple of years ago, I visited Calder Glen High in East Kilbride and I heard Ian speak. I was very humbled by his speech and I hope that his story helps our young people to keep alive the memories of the millions of people who suffered in that dark period of time. I hope everyone will reflect today, Holocaust Memorial Day, on the atrocity of genocide. Through education, we need to ensure we build that ethos of tolerance and respect for all. We need to remember the words of Ian Forsyth, who urged us to stand together against oppression whenever we see it. We need to act to ensure that one day, genocide will be a thing of the past.
Thank you very much, Ms. Stevenson. And I call Maggie Chapman to be followed by Co-Cap Stewart again for around 4 minutes, Ms. Chapman.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And thanks to Jackson Carlow for his motion, for securing this debate today, and for his very passionate speech earlier. The Holocaust does not sit in isolation. It emerged from a broader culture of racism based on conspiracy theories. Whilst the actions of the Nazi regime stand out, they are a part of a history of oppression of minorities in Europe, stretching back centuries. Anti-Semitism was widespread in early 20th century Europe. The Tsarist forgery of the Protocols of the Elders of Zion crystallised a number of accusations against the Jews of Europe. Many of the anti-Semitic tropes we see today, including the spurious claim about control of finance and the media, feature in those protocols. At a time when the circulation of myths and untruths in the media are especially problematic, we must learn from this situation. Just as mass literacy allowed credulous people to be taken in by forgeries, so mass communication allows for fake news to spread. Anti-Semitism was common at the highest levels of society, from Henry Ford to the British royal family. The actions of the Nazis were horrific, but were based on a set of beliefs that circulated and were accepted widely. One anti-Semitic conspiracy that we must confront is the replacement theory, expounded by associates of former US President Donald Trump and others. As recently as 2017, neo-Nazis marched in Charlottesville, North Carolina, chanting, "Jews will not replace us." Given the determination of many to import US trends wholesale, we must ensure we reject this pernicious idea. It is dangerous to isolate the actions of the Nazis from those of wider society. As Primo Levi points out, and I quote, "Monsters exist, but they are too few in number to be truly dangerous. More dangerous are the common men, the functionaries, ready to believe and to act without asking questions." End quote. Violence sprung from a well of prejudice and was not limited to the years 1941 to 45. It sits in a long history of attacks on Jews, a history that stretches from the massacre of Jews at Clifford's Tower in York in 1190, through the persecution of the Jews of Iberia in the 15th and 16th centuries, to the Tsarist pogroms of the late 19th and early 20th century. Each of these rounds of persecution was the result of threats to the established order. Lashing out at minorities is a common tactic, and we must not forget that it is not just Jews who have been treated in this way. The Holocaust was an act of power that attacked Roma and Sinti people and LGBTQI people. In the week where the UK has been criticised for its growing culture of hostility towards LGBTQI people, we need to take that seriously. We in this Parliament need to consider our actions very carefully. We have seen an enormous rise in anti-trans hate crime. We have seen Roma communities and Scottish traveller communities used for the cheapest of political point scoring. We are at risk of contributing to exactly the atmosphere of hate against minorities from which the Holocaust sprang. Hate doesn't always come in jackboots. Sometimes it arrives wearing a nice suit, muttering about justified concerns, creating an environment where prejudice can slip into violence. It is a task for all of us to prevent the atmosphere of hate that leads to violence. So we have a duty to tackle prejudice right now, not just when hate turns violent. Then, one day, we will have created a better world.
Thank you, Ms. Chapman. I now call on Cocab Stewart to be followed by Alex Cole Hamilton. Again, 4 minutes, Ms. Stewart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I would like to express my sincere thanks to Jackson Carlaw for securing this motion, and I'm honoured to speak in this debate. I'd also like to acknowledge the educators up and down the country and across the world who are teaching about Holocaust Memorial Day to our next generations. It can be difficult to know where to begin or what words to use when attempting to contemplate such an atrocity, something that was expressed by Holocaust survivor Sonia Weitz in 1995, 50 years after the liberation of Auschwitz. In a poem read aloud to a group of middle school students in the United States, she proffered, "Come, take this giant leap with me into the other world, the other place where language fails and imagery defies." To educate ourselves and confront the most painful, depraved aspects of our history is to take this giant leap, and in our struggle to comprehend the incomprehensible, survivor testimony has always been one of the strongest tools we have. As such, I would like to thank the Scottish Jewish Heritage Centre in my constituency of Glasgow Kelvin in Garnet Hill for sharing stories with me and for keeping these memories alive through an extensive collection of refugee testimonies, documents, information about how the Nazi regime impacted the lives of people here in Scotland. And Jackson Carslaw is quite right to emphasise the personal as we commemorate. And on my visit, I saw two such examples of the personal that struck me in particular through the archives that were left. Dorothy Marianne Oppenheim was Jewish. She was just 7 years old in July 1939 when she left Kassel in Germany and came to Scotland on the Kindertransport just weeks before the outbreak of the Second World War. Her grandfather had received an Iron Cross for his services in the Red Cross in the First World War, as did her father, Hans Oppenheim, a Dragoons officer. This could not save them, though, from the Nazis. Dorothy's parents were unable to follow their daughter to Scotland and later perished in Auschwitz. A young Christian couple from Edinburgh, Fred and Sophie Gallimore, took in the young girl. Dorothy lived and worked in Scotland, later marrying Andrew Sim in 1952 and raised her own family in Ayrshire. When Dorothy passed away in 2012, her family gifted thousands of documents, letters, photographs, papers, books and artefacts to the Scottish Jewish Archives Centre. The other story that struck me was of Hilda Goldwag. Hilda was a talented young Jewish artist living in Vienna with her widowed mother. She escaped to safety in Scotland in April 1939, thanks to the Domestic Bureau, a Jewish and Quaker initiative which secured her a UK domestic visa. Hilda was then exempted from internment as a refugee from Nazi oppression and was permitted to work whilst living in Glasgow, raising funds for the war effort. Later, she worked as a textile and graphic designer and was a prolific painter. Hilda lost her family in the Holocaust and remained in Glasgow for the rest of her life. For these people and the estimated thousands upon thousands of Jewish refugees that came to Scotland before, during and after the Second World War, this country was their salvation. We represented safety, acceptance and a light in the darkest of times. Without Scotland, the fates of many of these individuals hardly bears thinking about. In conclusion, as this debate has demonstrated, it is rarely an unproductive or fruitless endeavour for a nation to consider its role in history. Countries must take ownership of the individual parts that they have played and reflect on the lessons learned, however painful. In this chapter, Scotland chose compassion for those who had been denied the most basic human rights, and we must take this opportunity here on Holocaust Memorial Day to consider those in need of compassion today. Thank you.
Thank you very much indeed. Ms Stewart, before calling the next speaker, I'm conscious that there are a considerable number of members who still wish to participate in the debate, so I'm minded to take a motion without notice under Rule 8.14.3 to extend the debate by up to half an hour, and I call on Jackson Carlow to move such a motion.
So moved, Presiding Officer.
Thank you very much indeed, Mr Carlow. The question is that we extend the business for up to 30 minutes. Are we all agreed? Thank you very much indeed for that. That is agreed. And with that, I call on Alex Cole-Hamilton, who will be followed by Emma Harper for around 4 minutes, Mr. Cole-Hamilton.
Thank you very much indeed, Deputy Presiding Officer. It is a solemn privilege for me to rise for my party this afternoon to mark Holocaust Memorial Day. And I'm very grateful to Jackson Carlow for bringing this motion to Parliament and for his typically excellent and very moving speech at the top of the proceedings. Presiding Officer, when we remember the Holocaust, we are reflecting on one of the most horrific and barbaric acts in human history, the mechanised slaughter of 17 million people, more than a third of them Jewish, entire communities, huge segments of entire races, and indeed anyone the Nazis found to be in any way deviant or defective as they saw it in their worldview. They were rounded up and shipped to camps like Auschwitz and Belsen and murdered. Today is also an important opportunity to remember the victims of other genocides, and we've heard something of them today around the world in our own time, and the Uyghur Muslims living in China today who are facing persecution as we speak. All of them tyrannized, oppressed, and tormented simply because of who they are. Presiding Officer, as Maggie Chapman reminds us through the words of Primo Levi, monsters are real and they may wear business suits or military uniforms, but they have walked amongst us. We see the evidence of their works in the bleaker chapters of human history, and today we mark the darkest chapter of them all. Monsters are real, and the horrors of the Holocaust are a grim and obscene reminder of what can happen when we fail to recognise them, when we turn a blind eye to them. Horrific acts of this kind are enabled oftentimes by the passivity of those with the power and the agency to act but choose not to. Eli Wiesel, himself a survivor of Auschwitz, warns us against this when he tells us we must take sides. Neutrality helps the oppressor, never ever the victim, and that silence helps the tormentor, never the tormented. The haunting memorial to the murdered Jews of Europe, standing as it does in the heart of Berlin, symbolises the particular horror that can occur when those in power become corrupted and domination trumps any sense of service to one's fellow human being. There is no limit to how bleak things can become. We must remember that this regime was only made possible with the blind capitulation of thousands of otherwise normal people. The Nazis were successful at mass murder because they desensitised it, they normalised it, they inured every level of government and military to atrocity with endless layers of bureaucracy that reduced millions of precious lives to simple lines in a ledger book. It was described as the banality of evil by Hannah Arendt in her book about the trial of Adolf Eichmann. In these times of relative harmony and liberty, it is vital that we do not become complacent to the danger of something like the Holocaust ever happening again. Indeed, if you'd warned somebody living in Bremen or in Cologne in 1930 of what would unfold in the coming years, they might well have told you that something like that could never happen here, and certainly not here. We must not become complacent. We must remember. Presiding Officer, I often tell the story of an incident in 2019 when I spent some time in hospital and the man in the bed opposite volunteered his belief that the Holocaust was a hoax. In the argument that followed on the ward, he revealed that the basis for his position was rooted in videos that he had seen on YouTube. And just this week, a school board in the United States voted unanimously to ban a Pulitzer Prize-winning graphic novel, an allegorical tale about the Holocaust. Challenging anti-Semitism and Holocaust denial falls to each of us. We have seen the grim evidence of its revival in the rise of casual anti-Semitism in UK politics and in the mass shootings and hostage-taking in US synagogues. This isn't going away, and we must do everything that we can to stamp it out. Presiding Officer, the fact that we are here, living amongst many of the communities and the minority groups that the Holocaust and the Nazi regime sought to extinguish, and the fact that we stand united in this chamber in our remembrance of them and these awful events and in our opposition to the twisted ideologies they were born out of is evidence that the Nazis failed, that this sort of darkness will always fail and that the human spirit will triumph over evil. Let us ensure with every fibre of our being that remains so.
Thank you very much indeed, Mr. Cole Hamilton. And I call on Emma Harper, who will be followed by Stephen Kerr for 4 minutes, Ms. Harper.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm thankful to have the opportunity to speak in this hugely important Holocaust Memorial Day debate, and I congratulate Jackson Carlow on securing it and for his powerful speech. Holocaust Memorial Day provides us with an important opportunity to reflect on and remember the tragedy of the Holocaust and the atrocities committed. Presiding Officer, it is extremely important that young people in particular have the opportunity to visit the sites of the concentration camps and experience for themselves what, for me, was only reflected in school history books. I recognise the work of the Holocaust Educational Trust and its continued commitment to supporting our young people's education. I also want to mention the work of Vision Schools Scotland, started by the University at West of Scotland, which I became involved with after being invited to join by Jackson Carlow in 2019. I was due to visit Auschwitz with young people from the programme in 2020, but this was unfortunately cancelled due to the pandemic. As many young people, particularly in Scotland and across the Western world, have no lived experience of far-right extremism and of the hatred and intolerance that comes with it, I agree that education is key in ensuring such atrocities do not repeat themselves. Presiding Officer, I will share with members an experience that gave me a physical connection with the Holocaust, which I have mentioned in chamber before, but which is worth repeating as it demonstrates the impact of the Holocaust on survivors. I was a recent arrival in Los Angeles in California in the 1990s, and I was in the operating room at Cedars-Sinai about to assist a surgeon with the removal of a gallbladder from a 76-year-old patient. The woman, who was of German origin, had been resident in LA for 50 years. She was very frightened of her surgery and of being put under anaesthesia, and I reassured her that we would look after her and keep her safe. And I held her hand, and when I looked down, I saw her outstretched forearm on the surgical arm board, and on her arm there was a tattoo, pale grey set of numbers, 162753. I was overwhelmed with a quick flood of emotions, shock, anger and compassion all at once, so much so that I'm not even sure I remember the correct numbers. But I definitely remember how they made me feel and what they still do today. And what's burned in my memory is that pale grey tattoo, the significance of those numbers and the rush of emotions. I was 26 years old when I looked after that lady, and I thought about how when she was 26, she was there. She was a survivor. And the numbers that had been like forced on her or assaulted onto her, on her delicate skin, had made a permanent lifelong mark. But more important, it was proof that she survived the horrors and nightmares of Auschwitz. The inhumane imprint on that woman had been part of my memories for 25 years. And the visits that ensure that Waynes are involved in learning and that the memories of that survivor have contributed to my continuing care about other victims of oppression across the planet. Presiding Officer, I want to conclude, because I'm looking at the time, I want to conclude with a mention of Jane Haining Project. It's a new group created. It's creating a national essay writing competition so that we can continue to remember Jane Haining. She's the daughter of a farmer in Dunsker near Dumfries. She was an amazing, brave woman who died in Auschwitz after refusing to abandon Jewish children in her care in Budapest as a missionary. Jane Haining is the only Scot to be honoured as righteous among the nations. The term was used for non-Jews who risked their lives to protect Jews from extermination by the Yad Vashem Holocaust Memorial Centre in Jerusalem. So we'll end by using the words of Jane Haining. She said, "If these children need me in the days of sunshine, how much more do they need me in the days of darkness?" Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Harper. And I call on Stephen Kerr to be followed by Paul McLennan for 4 minutes. Mr. Kerr.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. The mention of Yad Vashem brings back memories of a visit that my wife and I made to Yad Vashem in Jerusalem and all of the emotions that go with that. And I'd like to thank my colleague Jackson Carlaw for not only securing this debate and giving an excellent speech, but also for all of his work over so many years as a champion for the Scottish Jewish community. And before I begin, I'd also, Deputy Presiding Officer, declare my interest as a member of the Board of Trustees of Freedom Declared Foundation, a charity which aims to promote freedom of religion or belief within the United Kingdom. Because like other members who are present in the Chamber right now, I'm a member of a religious minority myself, which has seen a long history of persecution and misrepresentation. And it's maybe because of that religious heritage that I feel acutely aware of the dangers of marginalising and othering people because of their faith, resulting in my own personal sense of mission to call out religious persecution in all its guises. The Holocaust remains one of the most horrific examples of religious persecution the world has ever seen, and it is right that we have a specific day in the calendar to remember it. When reflecting... Yes, of course.
Jeremy Balfour.
I'm grateful to the member. Would you agree with me that one of the positive ways that we can remember the Holocaust is that for all members and for all political parties to endorse the IHR definition of anti-Semitism, and until all parties in Scotland do that, there is always going to be a black mark against us.
Mr. Kern, I can give you the time back.
Thank you to my colleague Jeremy Balfour for that intervention. Yeah, I do find it regrettable and almost beyond belief that the First Minister has invited two ministers into her government who have refused to sign the International Holocaust Remembrance Alliance definition of anti-Semitism. I hope, given the fact the First Minister stayed for the very first part of this debate, that she might reflect on that as a result of this debate. I was saying that when reflecting on the horrors of the Holocaust, I'm always brought back to the words of the renowned BBC journalist Richard Dimbleby, reporting what he experienced on entering the concentration camp at Bergen-Belsen as it was liberated by British soldiers. A report so graphic and so distressing that the BBC initially contemplated not broadcasting it as he had sent it. Dimbleby said, "In the shade of some trees lay a great collection of bodies. I walked about them trying to count. There were perhaps 150 of them flung down on each other, all naked, all so thin that their yellow skin glistened like stretched rubber on their bones. Some of the poor, starved creatures whose bodies were there looked so utterly unreal and inhuman that I could have imagined that they never lived at all." This is just a glimpse into the horror that Richard Dimbleby witnessed and reported on. And for any member who has not listened to Richard Dimbleby in his own words and in his own voice make that report, I urge them to listen to it on the BBC website as part of their commemoration of today. A question that I often ask myself, as others have posed in this debate, is what lessons have we as humanity really learned from this destruction? If we had truly learned, would we have seen the genocides at Darfur or Bosnia or Rwanda? If we had truly learned, would we see the current situation in China? Last December, the Uyghur Tribunal in London concluded that the People's Republic of China had committed genocide, crimes against humanity, and torture against Uyghurs and other minorities. The tribunal found evidence of enforced abortions, the removal of the wombs of women against their will, the killing of babies immediately after birth, and mass sterilisation enforced through the insertion of IUD devices, which were removable by surgical means only. To honour the memory of the Holocaust, we must stand up for the Uyghurs and other minorities in China and elsewhere. And while it's right to call out religious persecution overseas, we also have a responsibility to ensure that every member of the Scottish population feels welcome in Scotland, regardless of their faith or belief. It's too easy for insults to become intolerance, for misunderstanding to become misrepresentation, and for principle to become prejudice. We must be on our guard. Deputy Presiding Officer, to conclude, it is my hope that Scotland, alongside the rest of our United Kingdom, will be a world leader in stopping the spread of ideologies that promote hatred and division. It is unacceptable to marginalise people because of their faith or belief, race, ethnicity, sex or sexuality. One day, may we collectively, as a human race, recognise in one another a brother and a sister and treat each other as such.
Thank you very much indeed, Mr. Kerr. I now call on Paul McLennan to be followed by Paul O'Kane for 4 minutes. Mr. McLennan.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer, and thank you to Jackson Carloff for tabling this motion and his moving speech. And I'm genuinely humbled to be speaking in this debate today for the first time. 77 years ago today, Soviet soldiers marched into Birkenau. The liberation of thousands of Jewish people left to die by the SS was not part of their plans. They found 88,000 pairs of glasses, hundreds of prosthetic limbs, 44,000 pairs of shoes, 6,350 kilograms of human hair. They also found 648 corpses and more than 7,000 starving camp survivors. I visited Auschwitz-Birkenau in 2019. I've seen the extensive grounds. The scale is incredible. The original camp blocks, the guard towers and the hundreds of thousands of personal possessions brought by deportees. Deportees who had no idea they were brought there to be immediately killed in the gas chamber or forced into slave labour by the Nazis. My experience of Auschwitz-Birkenau has stayed with me since. One particular memory on that day, I watched around 20 Israeli teenagers standing around the Star of David flag, praying in tears. I can picture that right now. It will stay with me. In East Lothian, Whitcham Farm School was a shelter for Jewish children seeking refuge in Britain as part of the kinder transport mission. From 1939 to 1941, the school was home to 160 children whose parents were killed in the Holocaust. This year's Holocaust Memorial Day theme, One Day, calls on us to use one day to remember the past and create a world that will one day be free from fascism, genocide and the politics of hate. For those who suffered for days, weeks, months, years, focusing on just one day is a starting point, a snapshot in time that helps bring a small piece of the full picture to life. One day is a way for us to learn about what happened during the Holocaust and the genocides that followed in Cambodia, Rwanda, Bosnia and Darfur. One day to hear the testimonies, the life histories and the names of the millions of men, women and children who were murdered during the Holocaust and genocides since because of who they are. As the horrors of the Nazi Holocaust begin slowly to fade from the living memory, it is so important that we actively remember the events that conspired, honour the survivors and educate ourselves about those who lost their lives and suffered. So today, I'm thinking about those victims and survivors, families and communities whose stories have all been but lost. I'm reflecting on the hate that caused the Holocaust and other genocides, and I'm taking a moment to commemorate Holocaust Memorial Day and remember those who lost their lives to oppression and hate. As George Santayana famously said, he who does not learn from history is doomed to repeat it. Today is a day for commemoration and action to build a better future for all of us. We all have a moral obligation to tackle, challenge, debate, discuss, expose and teach about the attitudes and behaviours that allowed the Holocaust and other genocides to happen. We can never, never forget the inhumanity of the Holocaust as we work today to protect human rights in today's world. And may we never allow such human atrocities to happen ever again. My thoughts today are with everyone whose life has been impacted by these horrors. Thank you.
Thank you very much indeed, Mr McLaren. I now call on Paul O'Kane to be followed by Stuart McMillan again, around up to 4 minutes, please.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. It is an honour to rise and speak in this debate as we mark Holocaust Memorial Day 2022. And I wish to pay a warm tribute to Jackson Carlaw for securing this debate. I have known Jackson for many years, and we've both sought to serve the interests of the people of East Renfrewshire, our home. We have often sparred on various policy matters, but on the vital importance of Holocaust remembrance, we have stood four square, particularly with our Jewish friends and neighbours, for whom this remembrance is so deeply personal and important. And I'm sure he will join me in commending the ongoing efforts of East Renfrewshire Council, the Glasgow Jewish Representative Council, interfaith groups and the wider civic society in East Renfrewshire for their ongoing commitment to remembering the Holocaust and seeking to build bridges of respect and understanding between the many diverse communities we are proud to serve. I should also take this opportunity to acknowledge the excellent work of the Holocaust Memorial Day Trust and the Holocaust Educational Trust, among the custodians of remembrance of the Holocaust in the UK. And in particular, I want to mention another East Renfrewshire name, Kirsty Robson. Kirsty first became involved with Holocaust education whilst at school, participating in the Lessons from Auschwitz programme, which takes groups of young people to the site of the camps, as we've heard from other members today. Kirsty then took the opportunity to share her experiences with fellow pupils at Barhead High School and beyond. And Kirsty now works supporting the Memorial Day and Educational Trust, and her passion and determination is really an inspiration. Kirsty has also brought together survivors from Rwanda, Bosnia and Darfur to share their stories, and she continues to work on modern genocide prevention and education, including the investigation into what is currently happening with the Uyghurs in China and other human rights abuses around the world. Because although we say never again, we know that all too often it does happen again. And with each passing generation, and as we lose more of the survivors of the horrors of the Holocaust, it falls to all of us to pick up the flame of remembrance and education, to call out anti-Semitism, racism, homophobia, transphobia and disabled views and actions when we see them, and to speak truth to power when we see discrimination, hatred and the othering of people. This year's theme for Holocaust Memorial Day is One Day, and we are asked to reflect on one day in the magnitude of what happened, to reflect and learn from it. Today I want to reflect on one day that really opened my eyes to the real experiences of the Holocaust. When I was a fairly new councillor in East Renfrewshire, I had the great honour of helping to host a civic afternoon tea for Judith Rosenberg, Scotland's last Auschwitz survivor, of whom Jackson Carlaw has spoken so powerfully. I remember that you could hear a pin drop as Judith told her story. She spoke of the day her life changed in 1944, when at 22 years old she was deported by the Nazis from her middle-class life in the town of Gyáhungry to Auschwitz with her timber merchant father, mother and sister. On the platform at Auschwitz, the men were sent to the left and the women to the right, and it was the last time she would see her father. And for those in the chamber who, like me, have visited Auschwitz-Birkenau, I am sure that the memory of standing at that particular spot is forever etched in our memories. Indeed, I also think on the theme of one day, on that day that I visited Auschwitz-Birkenau, and the overpowering, deafening silence on the long walk from the site of the gas chambers along the railway tracks to the infamous watchtower. The memorial reads, "Forever let this place be a cry of despair and a warning to humanity, a warning that we all too often fail to heed. But for all Judith Rosenberg endured, I never sensed bitterness from her. She said, "After the war, I felt that though Hitler was bad to me, not all Germans were bad. When I was a child, my father taught me that all people are equal, that it doesn't matter who or what race they are just people. I think we should all remember that. If we do, then I am not pessimistic." Those words are some of the most powerful I have ever had the privilege to hear. As we've heard, Judith passed away last year, almost to the day. So in concluding, Deputy Presiding Officer, in remembering the 6 million Jews murdered during the Holocaust, alongside the millions of other people killed in the Nazi persecution of other groups, and in the genocides that followed in Cambodia, Rwanda, Bosnia and Darfur, let us remember Judith Rosenberg's words and turn all of our efforts to one day truly being able to say, never again. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr O'Kane. I now call the final speaker in the open debate, Stuart McMillan, for up to 4 minutes, please, Mr McMillan.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. First of all, I want to congratulate Jackson Carlaw for securing this important members' debate and also to thank him for his powerful contribution. Jackson Carlaw is correct that across this chamber there is a unified position and our determination to help educate future generations. The Holocaust Memorial Day debate is an annual debate, and that is absolutely right. We should never forget nor allow the atrocities of the Holocaust to be forgotten. The Holocaust is an example of how brutal regimes can have a long-lasting effect upon societies in perpetuity. I've spoken in some of these members' debates in the past, and I've previously highlighted my experience when I went to visit Auschwitz a number of years ago. Nothing can prepare you for the experience and effect of going to Auschwitz and also what that effect will have upon you. I and others at least had the chance to leave that day. 960,000 Jews were murdered by the Nazis there, and 6 million Jews were murdered during the Holocaust. Attempting to comprehend the sheer scale of these atrocities is impossible, and we owe it to present and future generations to do all that we can to both educate and work with the various organisations who work in our schools and with our young people to ensure that they know of this particular part of history. This will be an activity that must happen long after every one of us is no longer walking this earth. And in my opinion, the day society decides stop telling this part of history is the day that the world gives up. 2 days ago, it was reported that a Dutch tourist was fined after giving a Nazi salute at Auschwitz. First of all, this action is abhorrent. And secondly, it shows that there is still a job to be done to educate people about the Holocaust. There is no justification for any such action take place anywhere. When I walked into Auschwitz, I became numb. The silence was deafening and the eeriness was startling. I've never felt anything like it, and I don't want to again. As you walk about Auschwitz, you see the various rooms where torture took place, the shower rooms where people were gassed, the crematorium where bodies were burned, the wall where people were shot. And probably one of the most striking, it was the room full of shoes of the victims of people who perished at the hands of the Nazis. During also, I have had the privilege of hearing the testimony in this parliament of survivors of the Nazi regime. And the theme for today's Holocaust Memorials Day debate is One Day. This is fitting and it provides a sense of hope. Without hope, we have got nothing. One day we hope to live in a world with respect for others instead of what is all too often the case. The Holocaust and the numerous examples of genocide MSPs have raised today are examples of how much we still need to do. We do need to rededicate ourselves to do all that we can, and I would like to think that one day, respecting religious and ethnic backgrounds and the eradication of intolerance becomes a reality. Thank you.
Thank you very much indeed, Mr McMillan. I now call on the Cabinet Secretary to close the debate for around 7 minutes, please, Ms Robinson.
Thank you very much, Deputy Presiding Officer. Can I begin by thanking Jackson Carlaw for tabling the motion and highlighting the significance of Holocaust Memorial Day and what was an incredibly powerful
speech. I have to say, all of the speeches I've heard during this debate have been very moving and very powerful, but I think Jackson Carlow's was particularly so. And his very fitting tribute to the life of the late Judith Rosenberg was very, very important as Scotland's last Auschwitz survivor. So thank you for that. I just wanted to also reflect on Jackson Carlow's reference to the end of living history and how significant and important that is. And I guess my own personal reflection of that is that my late mum was in a school in Manchester when a number of children arrived, and this would have been the start of the war, on the kinder transport. And none of the children, her as well, had any idea why these children were arriving. There was a real lack of awareness of the absolute horror of what was unfolding hundreds of miles away. But during the course of getting to know these children, my mum had a real awareness raising of the horrors of what was going on, and prejudice and racism and anti-Semitism. And that had a profound effect on her life and her views of politics, of fairness, and a real interest in the international community, of things that were going on that shouldn't be happening. And she, I guess, passed a bit of that on to me. And I've tried with my daughter to tell her of some of those lived experiences, because they're so, so powerful. But as we see the last of that lived experience, unfortunately, leaving our earth, we have to find ways of capturing that testimony and making sure that the next generation and the generation after that hear that first-hand testimony of what happened. And we must continue to remember all of those from minority communities who were persecuted and murdered by the Nazi regime, and of course their collaborators, as we've heard, millions of people from the Jewish community, but also disabled people, gay people, Roma, Sinti people, and anyone else who was deemed to be different, the othering of people. And while we honour the memories of those who lost their lives, it's also important to amplify the voices of those who survived the Holocaust. And we are fortunate to still have some of them alive today. And I was privileged to contribute to the official Scottish National Holocaust Memorial Ceremony last night. And in particular, the testimony of Henry Wuga, who remembers the destruction of synagogues and homes of his Jewish friends and family being destroyed and many being taken away to concentration camps, and Eric Eugenie Murangwa, who was protected from being killed during the genocide in Rwanda by his fellow football players. Heart-wrenching, but also inspiring. Henry and Eric and others like them who have borne witness to the depths of evil embody extraordinary resilience to ensure the horrors of genocide are never erased from our collective memories, and to remind us of that vital refrain of never again. And it's natural for us to want to consign these painful memories to the past, but a key component to preventing further acts of genocide is the sharing the truth of this dark period with each new generation. Our children, our children's children, have to understand where hatred and intolerance can lead when left unchallenged. And as time passes, we must do all we can to ensure the memory of the Holocaust doesn't fade, and moments like this in our Parliament are important. Yes, of course.
Jamie Green. Can I thank the Cabinet Secretary for those words? And lessons absolutely should be learned. Is it the case, therefore, that the Scottish Government will unequivocally condemn those in Scottish society who are calling for boycotts and sanctions against those of Israeli descent, which are fueling much of the anti-Semitism, not least in Scottish universities and educational institutions, which we are clearly seeing a rise in attacks of anti-Semitism in those areas? And will the Scottish Government be absolutely clear that all members of its government absolutely condemn all sorts of language which is fuelling this very unfortunate and unwanted rise? Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I think language is important, and it's really important to distinguish between the Israeli people and actions of a government. And I think it's legitimate to criticise actions of governments across the world, but not to put that on to a people, because that is wrong. So language does matter. So I hope that helps to answer Jamie Green's point. I wanted to go on to Professor Joe Goldblatt because he reminded us recently that Holocaust Memorial Day is critically important for the current as well as future generations, because through their enlightenment there remains the hope that future Holocausts and genocides will be less likely to occur. And that's why the Scottish Government continues to support Holocaust Memorial Day Trust to promote and support the Memorial Day in Scotland. And, of course, the Scottish Government also continues to support the Holocaust Educational Trust's Lessons from Auschwitz project, which has been delivered as a bespoke online educational programme throughout the pandemic. Deputy Presiding Officer, we've heard from across the Chamber some of the ways the theme of one day can be interpreted. Sadly, the one day of liberation of Auschwitz many were waiting for did not bring an end to the types of suffering the world witnessed during that period. As times passed, hatred and intolerance has continued to blight the lives of many across the world, with more lives lost to these pernicious forces in places such as Cambodia, Rwanda, Bosnia and Darfur. And sadly, millions of people across the world today are forced to flee horrendous violence and the threat of being killed, yearning for one day free from such unimaginable strife. Days like today remind us that our work is not yet done. Indeed, Scotland has a long history of welcoming people from all nationalities and faiths, including those seeking refuge and asylum from war and terror elsewhere. And that includes Henry Wooga, who fled to Glasgow from Nuremberg on the Kinder transport, leaving his family behind. And Henry will never forget his newly adopted home, where he settled with his wife Ingrid and had family of their own. Focusing on one day allows us to recognise and reflect on all of those individual journeys, challenges, feelings of displacement and loss, and these are hugely personal and unique. And that highlights the importance of putting lived experience and equality, inclusion and human rights at the heart of our policy making here in this Parliament. To conclude, Deputy Presiding Officer, Holocaust Memorial Day not only allows us to commemorate the victims of the Holocaust and subsequent genocides, it also reinforces our ongoing collective duty to the present to counter all forms of bigotry and prejudice. Hate must always be confronted and condemned, and the humanity of each individual recognised and celebrated. These are the foundations of a decent society, and it's something I have no doubt unites every one of us here in this chamber. This evening I'll be joining others at the UK National Holocaust Memorial Day Trust virtual event, and I will light a candle with others to light the darkness by lighting a candle in my window at 8 o'clock to remember those who were murdered simply for who they were. We will never forget, and it's their suffering that should ignite in each of us a desire to build a kinder and more just tomorrow, one day free from hatred, prejudice and intolerance. Thank you.
Thank you very much indeed. Cabinet Secretary, that concludes the debate, and I suspend this meeting, albeit only briefly, until 2:30.